Hello students, this video from EdWT will discuss chapter 7 of economic survey, volume 1, chapter 7, that is physical capacity for the 21st century. So in this chapter we will deal about tax administration and India's tax policy and all that, what are the changes that are needed, does India under tax and underspend and all that. So first the chapter starts with the upcoming changes or the recent changes that have been done in the tax system or the that are upcoming, the dramatic changes that are upcoming in the tax system of in India. So there are four changes that are being talked about. The first is the GST bill. GST bill is a much awaited bill that is being brought out by the government. Then second is the changes in the corporate tax structure. The corporate tax presently is levied at somewhere around 30%, but the effective corporate tax comes down to only 23%. So basically the government in last budget talked about phasing out the exemptions. There are various exemptions on corporate tax. So the government in the previous budget talked about phasing out these various exemptions over the period of next 4 years and bringing down corporate tax from 30% to 25%. The third change is here is that government is talking about cleaning the legacy of tax issues from the past. There have been many contentious adversarial tax issues from the past which the government is trying to clean up. The fourth point is there have been changes in the tax administration. Basically government set up a committee to consider changes in the tax administration. The committee was called TARC, Tax Administration Reforms Committee, under Partha Sarathy Shomu. The committee has made recommendations, wide ranging recommendations. It's very important for this year prelims as well as this year means. I will briefly highlight you over the recommendations of the TARC. One of the recommendations was removing the revenue secretary who is not a tax expert, who is not a tax administration expert, still he has the final say. It talked about merger of CBDT and CBEC. It talked about doubling IT pairs in the next 3 years. It talked about widening the uses and aspects of PAN. He coined it as CBIN. Please look up Partha Sarathy Shomu committee, that is TARC, T-A-R-C, Tax Administration Reforms Committee. So it also talked about bringing two new committees to handle tax administration. The government followed up on the recommendation and the two committees have been set up recently in February or March this year. The two committees are TPC and TPRU, Tax Policy Council and Tax Policy Research Unit. Now Tax Policy Council does all the research work and all the analysis on tax policy, how it will affect the tax collection and all that. The tax policy research unit basically does all the analysis. And the Tax Policy Council, which is headed by the finance minister, it considers all the research work that has been done by the TPRU, all these reports and all, and it advises upon the advises like what should the tax policy be. So basically, and even TPC's recommendations are advisory, they're not binding. So okay, so now the survey will talk about some findings that the survey has made. First thing is ki there are four special findings that the survey has made on India's tax system. First point is when you go on to simply compare India's India with other countries, we find that India under taxes as well as underspends. India both under taxes as well as underspends. So but this is we can see by simple comparison we find this that compared to like OECD countries, emerging markets, India is under taxing as well as underspending. But if we control for the development level of the economic development level of our country, India, then we find that India is not an outlier. India is not actually under-taxing or underspending. But then again, points have been raised that, do not worry, I will discuss all the four points in detail later on. But then some people made the point that for its political development level, like India is a democracy and a mature democracy, India is a thriving democracy. For a democratic country, we are taxing very less and spending very less, because a democratic country has to perform its role of welfare state, that is redistribution. So it's got to tax more and spend more for its welfare policies. But then again, this is not fair on India, because other democracies, they took a very long time to strengthen their tax capacity, while India's democratic experience has only been of say 70 years. But India is an outlier when it comes to number of individual taxpayers, individual income taxpayers. I mean, income taxpayer to voters ratio in India is merely 4%, while the desirable ratio should be 23%. Okay, so the above four points, we'll discuss them in detail in the rest of the chapter. This is what the chapter will focus on. So let's first start with the point that tax as such is an obligation of citizenship. I mean, democracy is like a contract between us, state and citizens. So it is the dimensions of it is that the state has a role to provide essential services and protect the less off by less well by redistribution and create conditions for prosperity, while the citizens part of the contract is to hold the state accountable when it fails to uphold the contract. So there's a contract between the democracy is called as a contract between state and citizens. So basically, tax here is an obligation of the citizen. Because if the citizen doesn't pay a tax, then what will he do? He will either become a free rider, basically he will just use the services without paying any tax, or he will choose to exit the state. He will not use the services of the state at all. Thus here, taxation is like a glue between the state and citizens. Well, on the other hand, citizens are willing to pay if state has sufficient legitimacy. Look, if state delivers essential services, citizens are ready to pay taxes. So basically, tax becomes an obligation of citizenship. So thus, tax doesn't depend merely on the designing of tax policies and their framing and their implementation, but it also depends on the legitimacy of the state. The more legitimate a state would be, the more the citizens will be willing to pay taxes. So I mean, government merely focuses on policy designing and implementation to increase taxes. It is not focusing on increasing its own legitimacy. So we'll cover this part also later on, how to increase its legitimacy and how legitimacy erosion has led to citizens, especially middle class, exiting the state. So first let's make a cross-country comparison. Matlab, does India undertax or underspend when it is compared to OECD or EME? The survey presents a simple table, makes a table where it considers the different compares India to different countries, where India has a merely such a small tax to GDP ratio. It has a tax to GDP ratio of 16.6%, while OECD average is somewhere around 34.2%, emerging market average is somewhere around 21.5%. So India is basically India is undertaxing. While if you see India's expenditure, even that is very low. India's expenditure is to its GDP is somewhere around 26%, while the emerging market economy's average is 31%, and OECD average is somewhere around 43%. And moreover, India's expenditure on human capital is even less. Human capital means health, education, and etc. is somewhere around 5%. Somewhere around 5%, while the emerging market average is somewhere around 7.5%. OECD average is somewhere around 11.5%. So basically, India is under taxing and under spending. If we go by simple comparisons, just compare the share, the total tax share to GDP with other countries. But this is merely a very simple comparison. Okay. And also, it shows that India's tax to GDP ratio has grown merely by 10% in the last 60 years. From 1950s to present date, India's tax to GDP ratio has grown by merely 10% merely, from 6%, somewhere around 6% to somewhere around 16%. But what the economic survey is saying, that accounting for the economic development level, India's fiscal capacity is good enough. Means India is not under taxing. India is neither under taxing nor under spending. Fiscal capacity means how much tax we collect, right? So India is not under taxing. If we account for our economic development level, how do we account for our economic development level? By not just comparing the ratio of tax to GDP with other countries, but by comparing it along the economic development level, by accounting for the economic development level, account for the economic development level by using GDP per capita. Per capita GDP is a good, it denotes the economic development level of a country. So, but then people have raised the there's a valid point that can be raised, that for its political development level, India is underspending and under taxing. Why? Because India is a democracy. It needs to spend and tax more so that it can, for redistribution purposes, for its welfare state purposes. So now we go on to, so we have to account for the political development level too of India. But here India appears as a negative outlier. When you compare tax to GDP ratio, while accounting for both economic and political development, and it is a much bigger negative outlier in case of expenditure on health and education. But again, the economic survey is saying that this too is an inappropriate comparison. Why? Because India is a very, relatively, India is a young democracy, and moreover, other democracies like US and Europe, they have built their capacities due to wars, World War One, World War Two, and due to certain shocks due to crisis or war and etc., like Great Depression. This led to the expansion of the state and the expansion of the welfare state. So it led to, and the need to refinance it, finance the expansion of welfare state. There was a need to finance the expansion of welfare state. For that, they had to raise their tax capacity. While India has not faced any such shocks. So it is again an inappropriate comparison. But so again, it is an inappropriate comparison. So okay, the second thing here is, second comparison that is being made is that the history of US and Europe and basically democratic economies shows that the state has to first provide essential services like security, health, education, infra and all that before it takes up its role of redistribution. Why? Because overemphasizing redistribution without providing basic public goods, if we overemphasize redistribution, if we go on to redistribute before the state goes on to provide basic public goods, then this will create a risk of the middle class exiting from the state. The middle class might choose to exit because the middle class does not see any, it cannot see any, it cannot perceive any benefits from the state. The middle class has to perceive that it is, yes, yeah, it is deriving some benefits from the state, then it will be willing to pay taxes, willing to finance redistribution. Unless the middle class views itself as perceiving any benefits from the state, it might choose to exit. Why would it pay taxes? It might choose to exit or become a free rider. So how would it exit the state? It would avoid paying taxes, it would try to minimize its tax liability, it would go to private hospitals, it would send their children to private schools and colleges. Such phenomenon is already evident in India. So such a middle class exit further erodes the legitimacy of a state, because it lowers accountability of a state. Basically, if the middle class does not pay taxes to the state, it will not hold the state accountable either. It will, matlab, its stake in holding the state, its stake, middle class ka stake in holding the state accountable is low if it does not pay any taxes to the state. So basically the accountability, in turn the accountability of the state also gets lowered. So it further facilitates, it further brings down the legitimacy of the state and further facilitates exit, which further brings down the legitimacy of the state, and this starts a vicious cycle. So if India wants to avoid the vicious cycle, India has to first prioritize providing basic essential services before it goes on to take up the task of redistribution on a so basically so the next point here is the that the economic survey discusses is that the economic survey will talk about the number of, it will discuss the number of taxpayers, the number of basically the economic survey now the economic survey will try to analyze if India is an outlier in the number of taxpayers that exist in our economy. So first and foremost, how many people pay taxes in India? Okay, so around 5.5% of the people who have an who make an income, who earn only 5.5% of them pay taxes in India. And moreover, the even more shocking fact is that 85% of the Indian economy is outside the tax net. Only 15% of our net national income, somewhere around 15.5% of our net national income was reported as gross taxable income. So basically 85% of entire economy is outside the tax net. It is not paying any taxes at all. So these are very shocking facts. First and foremost, why are people not ready to? Are people not ready to pay taxes? Are they trying to avoid taxes, or are they just simply out of the tax net for some other reason? So we'll talk about it in detail. We'll analyze it and we'll see what the reason is. So first and foremost, let's understand this. That in like a citizen is the a citizen whatever is that a citizen the accountability of a citizen weakens if they do not pay directly for the services that state provides. If the citizen is paying directly for the services that the state is providing, only then is the citizen willing to hold the state more accountable. Basically, if you have put money in something, it's a simple concept. If you spend money on something, then you expect something in return, right? If you not spend money on it at all, then whatever you get is like a bonus, right? So you are not going to hold the other party accountable for that. So accountability of the state comes down. So basically, and here indirect taxes are not perceived by citizens as their contributions to state. The point to understand here is that citizens only see direct taxes, income taxes, as their contributions to the state. So basically, indirect taxes also are their contribution to the state, but it is not so easy to perceive. They are not so immediate or direct enough to be perceived by citizens as their contributions to the state. So here the new GST bill, which is highly desirable, it won't impact citizen participation. The new GST bill won't impact citizen participation because GST bill focuses only on indirect taxes. So it will not impact citizen participation or democratic accountability and state willing. So hence we need to focus on the number of taxpayers, number of income taxpayers for trying to build the accountability of a state and for trying to build democratic accountability on the state. Okay, I'll explain the point once more. What he's saying is that कि लेट्स से कि इफ अ सिटीजन डज नॉट परसीव इटसेल्फ टू बी डायरेक्टली पेइंग फॉर द टैक्सेस दैट इट रिसीव फॉर द सर्विसेज दैट इट रिसीव्स फ्रॉम द गवर्नमेंट इफ अ सिटीजन डज नॉट परसीव इटसेल्फ टू बी डायरेक्टली पेइंग फॉर दैट देन ही विल नॉट बी होल्डिंग द गवर्नमेंट होल्डिंग द स्टेट accountable to a very large extent for those services. So basically, if the state is not being held accountable for those services, then the accountability of the state comes down. As the accountability of the state comes down, democratic accountability comes down, citizen participation comes down, state building comes down, and such. These are the fundamentals of democracy, right? So basically, our democratic accountability is getting eroded. Legitimacy of our state is getting eroded. So indirect taxes. So basically, what the next point is that indirect taxes are not direct enough, are not so immediate. That they are way too indirect, and thus they are perceived by citizens. They are not perceived by citizens as contributions to the state. They are not so direct or immediate to be perceived by citizens as their contributions to the state. So indirect taxes like GST won't impact citizen participation. So India has to focus on the number of taxpayers. So we have to increase our number of income taxpayer. Income tax is a tax that is directly felt by the taxpayer. So if a taxpayer pays income tax, he has paid some money to the government, so he's ready to hold the government accountable. He wants the government to pay him back through the services of the state. So he's ready to hold it accountable. So now if you see that only 4% of only 5.5% of all the earning people in India, okay, all the earning individuals in India are in the tax net. So earning for an economic development level for our GDP per capita, obviously at PPI levels, GDP per capita is that India doesn't seem to be an outlier. India is somewhere around the best fit, like the world average, somewhere around there. So India is not an outlier, it is not a negative outlier certainly. But if we see for the political development level of our country, India is an outlier. How do we account for the, how do we view the political development level of our country? So if we see that the political development is related with the, can be easily seen as the number of voters that India has. Okay, so if we see the number of taxpayers to the number of voters in India, that should be somewhere around the world average. So the desirable goal of taxpayer to voters is somewhere around 23%, but in India it is as low as 4%. So for our democratic development level, for our political development level, India has very low ratio of, India is an outlier, India has very low ratio of taxpayers to voters. So why is it happening? So why is it happening? Let's look at the reasons. One big point that the economic survey points out to is that it compares India to China. I mean, how did China bring more and more citizens into its individual income tax net? In its IT net, how did it manage to bring so many? And India was not able to. So what China did, it set up a reasonable threshold for paying taxes. Obviously, like you need, like someone below a certain level of income, it does not need to pay taxes. So because he should be able to avail the service of the state. This is what the concept of welfare state says. So China set up a reasonable threshold for paying taxes, and it over the years it has refrained from changing the threshold. But what has India done? I mean, India set up a reasonable threshold for income tax. Basically, there was an income tax exemption threshold, but India kept on revising it for political reasons, for populist policy. It was a populist policy. India kept on revising it. Basically, in 2000, somewhere around 2008 or 9, the level was somewhere around, the income tax exemption threshold was somewhere around 1.5 lakhs. Someone below 1.5 lakh income of less than 1.5 does not have to pay income tax. But now the level is somewhere around 2.5 lakhs. So India has continuously kept kept the sorry so India has been raising the income exemption threshold continuously over the years, and this is why there has been a phenomenon of missing taxpayers. That is, there has been a large number of people who have legitimately gone under the tax radar due to generous government policy, due to such a government policy. And look at the gap between the average income and between the average income and this exemption threshold. The gap, the wedge between the average income of an earning Indian, earning individual in India, and the exemption threshold has increased over the years. It has widened. So basically, the point is saying that India has to refrain from raising exemption thresholds anymore. So the implication is that there are very few people in the tax net in India who are paying income tax in India presently. The income tax net of our economy is very low. Many people are outside the income tax net because of this threshold. They do not have to pay taxes legitimately. So basically, if we stop raising the exemption threshold anymore, as the economy grows, naturally the tax net will grow. So let the growth in the economy let the natural growth in the economy account for the let the natural growth in the economy further the growth in the income tax, in the number of income taxpayer. It is a natural process. Why are you trying to hinder it? So basically, here India and China have differed, and hence the economic survey is saying that China has managed to increase the number of taxpayers while India has not. There's a box in this chapter. What it discusses is that it plots a graph. It takes up data from different surveys and plots a graph, and says that it goes on to point that there has been a massive growth, massive concentration of income at the top bracket in India. I mean, the top 1% income earners in India account for around 12.5% of total income. This data is from 2013-14. For top 1% account for 12.5% of total income. And this is somewhere close to the growth in the top 1% share, in their share in the total income. The growth over the last 15 years has been comparable to that in US. So even here, India is not an outlier, but it is a shocking fact. You can use it in your essays, you can use it in your GS answers, that top 1% income earners in India account for 12.5% of the total income of India. Okay, so now let's come to our conclusion. So what did the chapter talk about? The conclusion from the chapter is that one low hanging fruit, how do we build our fiscal capacity? One low hanging fruit is that India should refrain from raising exemption thresholds anymore. Absolutely. And the second point is, these are the recommendations that the economic survey makes. The second point is that let's prioritize our spending on essential services. The government has to prioritize its expenditure on essential services like law and order, public infra, pollution, health, education, all that, before it goes on to take up its role of redistribution. Basically, it needs to create legitimacy for itself so that people are ready to pay taxes. Third point here is that reduce corruption. Corruption has economic costs, it undermines the legitimacy of the state, so people are not ready to pay taxes because they believe that public resources are getting wasted. Their own taxpayer money is getting wasted, is going to wrong hands. The government is not able to use it efficiently. The fourth point is subsidies to the well-off should be scaled back. Now this is a point that has been discussed in detail in the previous chapter. The chapter's name was bounties to the well-off. For the well-off, I'll explain the point in a little. It says that the subsidies that India is giving in LPG, kerosene, electricity, aviation turbine fuel, in the implicit subsidy in small savings schemes, and etc. etc. And it talks about seven different areas. The subsidies that India is giving in these areas are not flowing to the intended beneficiary, the poor. I mean, it is not saying that it is not at all flowing to the poor, but major chunk of these subsidies are going to the well-off, to the rich, and a lot of it is going to the super rich as well. So basically, subsidies to the well-off needs to be scaled back. This will help in regaining legitimacy. And the first point here is improve property taxation. The economic surveys previously talked about the issues in property taxation. Like, property tax is presently being differently taxed at, or property is being differently taxed at all three levels of the government, local, state, and central. And moreover, there is very little data available on property tax. This shows that how little transparency and how little seriousness there is in property tax and property in matters of property tax and tax in India. So basically, why do we need to improve property taxation? Gives out four very, very beautiful points. Why there is a need to improve property taxation and reforms in property taxation. One, property tax is progressive and it is buy-in. Basically, property tax goes on the rich, so it is progressive. It is secondly, it is difficult to evade because it is levied on non-mobile goods. And given the extent of technology, it is, and non-mobile goods can be easily identified and they can be easily taxed. So basically, it becomes difficult to evade. Third, it can become an excellent potential source for local government's revenues. Okay, and the fourth is it will help control property speculation. So I think this is all. The entire chapter was focused on how and why to improve. What are the areas in how to improve tax policy in India, and how to bring in more people in the tax net, and how to increase legitimacy of the government, how the increasing the legitimacy of the government will legitimacy of the state will bring in more taxpayers. So thank you. I think we have covered the chapter very well, and so please share the video if you like it. And we'll come up with the rest of the videos, don't worry. And thank you for watching this video from EdmundTube.